Good evening. I'm Scott Showalter, president of the Oregon Symphony. Welcome to Illuminating Turangalîla, a discussion based around the Oregon Symphony's original multimedia production of Olivier Messiaen's Turangalîla Symphony, presented on December 3rd, 4th, and 5th at Arlene Schnitzer Concert Hall. Seated on stage with me are Brian Ferriso, director of Portland Art Museum, Carlos Kalmar, music director of the Oregon Symphony, and Rose Bond, video artist and chair of the Animated Arts Department at PNCA. Thanks to all of you for being here, and thanks especially to Brian for hosting us. This panel is the second in a three-part series that explores the intersection of various art forms and orchestral music. It follows the Oregon Symphony's own three-part series at the Schnitz called Sound Sights. The first, which many of you will remember, was produced in September, paired Bartok's Bluebeard's Castle with resplendent 14-foot-high Chihuly glass. The second production, which is the subject of tonight's program, is set against the backdrop of Messiaen's mammoth Turangalîla. Rose Bond creates original art using the walls of the Schnitz as her canvas. The third Sound Sights production arrives in May with a corollary panel discussion and combines the work of Michael Curry with Stravinsky's Persephone. These three Sound Sights productions are made possible by a generous grant from the Oregon Community Foundation, and Turangalîla in particular is underwritten by Umpqua Bank. We thank them for their support. Approximately 200 people have joined us today in person, and thousands more are viewing us live online via Facebook. I encourage all of you to let your Facebook friends know to watch us now. So unlike in the concert hall when I admonish you to turn off your cell phones, I actually encourage you to tweet and message away. We are also recording this production for future use. Following the panelists' discussion, we will open for questions from our in-person and online audiences. We will conclude our program and live stream at approximately 7:30 Pacific time and invite those in this room anyway to join us for a reception. Thank you for your interest in tonight's program and for your patronage of the arts in Portland and Southwest Washington. Let us begin. First, one question to each of you before we talk about Turangalîla specifically. Each of you is an artist and focuses in a particular genre, but you're also involved in multiple art forms. Could you briefly talk about such a multimedia mashup as what we're talking about today and its importance in the arts? Brian.
So I'll start. Thank you, Scott. And it's great to see everyone here and great to be on stage with Carlos and Rose, two very creative people. You know, this is really important for me because as I lead this institution, I reflect often on my own personal experiences as an artist. I actually studied painting at the Art Students League as well as at my undergraduate degree. And at that time, when I was in a liberal arts education, I was not only studying painting and drawing, but also had the very fortunate opportunity to study Beethoven's symphonies 1 through 9. And I remember very distinctly, in particular, Beethoven's symphony number 6, the Pastoral Symphony, and how that sort of embedded in me a spirit of harmony, as well as when I walked out and painted the landscape in Maine when I was going to school, how those two work together. So this idea of bridging the gap between the disciplines is so important to me and my own personal experiences. I'm so thrilled that we're exploring it in this community. And then finally, I'll say this, as we look at our educational system today, as we developed a community and a culture and a society, I can't imagine anything more important than having this conversation now. This idea of bringing the arts together, the life of the mind, the humanities, and really thinking deeply about what does beauty in the world mean, what does empathy mean, and I think this is what it's all about. So happy to be here. Scott, thanks for convening, and it's a pleasure.
So from my perspective, actually, I can only second what you just said. You stole my line already. I actually think that when you, like I do, when you have decades of experience conducting orchestras, conducting concerts, you realize after a while that although doing that and exposing yourself to the emotionality of classical music overall is one of the best things that can happen in your life, it's still there are some boundaries that remain, and I want to explore farther than them, because in essence, what happens in the world in which I live is I go to a concert hall, I dress up, I salute the audience, and then I turn my back. And that's all that happens. And my only experience in farm, as far as relating to other art forms, might be through opera or the spoken word. So I have already a tiny bit of experience in the sense of working together with artists that come from the spoken word theater as such, pairing theater with classical music, which might be something obvious, but this modern art form that did for sure not exist 40, 50 years ago, to just have an artist create something to a piece, and for me it's kind of, as a starting point, it's immaterial which piece it is. It's absolutely amazing because it also shows that we as the humankind have to get together, and we are capable of bringing the deepest emotions out, and as Brian said it, this is the time when we should be doing that.
Yeah, thank you. So as Scott said, I am a media artist. I'm deeply engaged in animation. And I think I see animation, when I say that to people, I think people think of certain things. You might think of Disney, you might think of Pixar, or whatever. I don't think of that. I think of this way to choreograph time. It's a visual thing, and it's like the kind of animation, this kind of cinema. It's like what you said, Carl. It's sort of there's this crossover that happens now in the arts, and we see that at PNCA. This kind of blurring between the departments as we figure out what screens are in our life, and how they're not just irritants, but how they may enrich us. So this has been an incredible experience for me. It's a new one. I think just I had to like train myself a bit. It's the sound sight series, not the sight sound series. and I think that what that means for me is I'm used to working generally from gathering visual elements, and the sound comes later. So this has been a really fresh experience for me. And I tell you, I jumped in the deep end on this work. It's really a beautiful monster of a piece, and I really would not be here in any kind of semblance of sanity were it not for the terrific team of students and alums that I worked with at PNCA, and I'll acknowledge you guys later, but if you could just stand up. We don't have too many. A lot of people had night classes and stuff tonight, but yeah, give them a hand.
Thanks to each of the panel for that opening. I offer now some background on the immense work of Turangalîla. 80 minutes of music performed over 10 movements. Now, lest this size scare you, I assure you that you will be absolutely taken with the Oregon Symphony's one-of-a-kind production in a few weeks. And to whet your appetite tonight, we'll offer several short clips and preview for the first time the tremendous animation by Rose and her team.
Sorry, this is a live discussion. One thing that I already want to tell you, because I have seen a tiny bit of Rose's work, that you probably will hear Turangalîla for the first time when you come all to the concert hall. I think one of the most fascinating things that I can imagine in this crossover is actually that both artworks that come together work independently but together. What I mean by that is, so you're going to see when you come to the concert hall the entire monstrosity of Turangalîla with Rose's not so monstrous artwork that she and your team created. And what I take from that is, because I know this, it will be fascinating. The other point that I want to make just before we start the real discussion about the work itself is, imagine what you will see with her work the exactly same visuals, but with a different piece of music, which could be possible, tricky, but possible. And imagine Turangalîla with a completely different artwork. I think that's the beauty of two worlds coming together, each of them independently, and now something is created together, and then we'll see what happens.
So what is this work all about? The influential conductor, Serge Koussevitzky, commissioned Turangalîla by Olivier Messiaen in 1945. Messiaen committed that he would write a work that would be, quote, beautiful and of significant proportions. He lived up to that. He completed the score in 1948, and following year, the then 31-year-old Leonard Bernstein conducted its premiere with the Boston Symphony. Despite its length and unusual instrumentation, Turangalîla has since received countless performances across the globe and become a core work in the orchestral canon. Koussevitzky said, quote, "My opinion is this symphony is, after the Rite of Spring, the greatest composed in our century." Now, he was the one who commissioned the work, so he might have been a little biased, although I think classical music lovers across the world would tend to agree. Messiaen brought together several diverse inspirations in Turangalîla, his early obsession with Debussy and his use of non-Western melodies, an interest in Hindu rhythms, and the medieval legend of Tristan and Isolde. There are many interpretations of this famous story, of course. In his, Messiaen explores the multidimensional joys of human love in all its forms. The composer offered this extensive explanation for his title. Turangalîla is a word in Sanskrit. Lila means play, in the sense of the divine action upon the cosmos, the play of creation, destruction, reconstruction, life, and death. Lila is also love. Turanga, this is time that runs like a galloping horse that flows like sands in an hourglass. Turanga is movement and rhythm. So Turangalîla then means all at once, love song, hymn to joy, time, movement, rhythm, life, and death. I suppose it's no wonder that it takes 80 minutes to address all of this material. Throughout his life, Messiaen experienced synesthesia, a neurological phenomenon in which one sensory experience involuntarily triggers another. He describes sensations of chromesthesia, the association of musical notes with colors. These colors are visually triggered when musical notes or chords are sounded. He wrote, "I am affected by a kind of synesthesia found more in my mind than in my body, which allows me, when I hear music and equally when I read it, to see inwardly, in the mind's eye, colors which move with the music, and I sense them in an extremely vivid manner. I paint colors for those who cannot see." First question to Carlos, how do you interpret this piece, and why is it fitting for your Sound Sights series?
Well, how I interpret this piece is kind of, let's wait and see. I mean, this is, let me just add one thing to this idea of this piece being a monstrosity. It's actually not that. I mean, it's overwhelming in a certain sense, and it's completely over the top, but it also has very different aspects, and we are going to get into that. And why this piece is so important in our Soundsides series is kind of very obvious, because I think that classical music audiences by now are kind of accustomed to live through the world of Gustav Mahler in his longer symphonies, and that is pretty much the same length like this Messiaen symphony. But for one reason or the other, this is a piece that doesn't happen so often in the concert hall. So in that sense, it's unusual, and it's unusually long. Now, with a piece of modern language music, and this is a modern language music, and with the added aspects of Indian and Hindu, and the very strange instruments or combination of instruments that are added, I thought this is the perfect piece for Soundsides, because anything that an inventive artist like Rose Bonds can do with a piece like that will just help the experience. And I know that whoever comes to our concert hall on the Saturday will definitely buy a second ticket for the Monday. Hint, hint.
Messiaen called this piece almost a piano concerto, and yet he included several non-traditional instruments, including this one. Carlos, what are we looking at?
Okay, this is actually kind of the only extremely unusual instrument. This is called Ont Martenot. It was invented in 1928 by Maurice Martenot. And if you have ever listened to one of the songs of the Beach Boys, there is a theremin there that's being used. This is kind of a theremin, just way more complex and can do way more things. Because a theremin, essentially, if you have ever never seen that, works in waves, one hand, and you never touch an instrument. And it sounds like, I know, we are being videotaped, this will be for eternity. And you, in a theremin, actually, you change volume with one hand and pitch with the other. Here, what you see is a keyboard. Now, if you observe the hands of this person, you see that actually he's tapping on something that is not on the keyboard. And there are loudspeakers, that's obvious. And this thing is very important. So you play on a keyboard, and that gives you an electronical sound according to whatever you want. But you also play on something that is on the side of the keyboard, where you see this guy pressing something, and you have a wire around this finger. So with what I sang already, that's one effect, because this guy can actually do what we call in music glissandi, from one note to the other. It does. But instead of explaining too much in words how this works, let's make maybe take a little listen. So you get an idea of what this instrument is. And one thing that this instrument, as opposed to many other electronical instruments, can do, and you saw that in the clip, is vibrato. It can vibrate. That's why the guy was constantly doing this at different speeds, which is the interesting point of the instrumentation in Turangalîla, is actually that Messiaen's idea, in part, is also to incorporate the human voice. And the closest he came to the human voice is actually an electronic instrument, what you just heard. And this is incorporated throughout the piece. It's very, very interesting.
We're now going to turn to three clips in various movements of the Messiaen. And we're going to see, preview for the first time, some of Rose's work as well. And I'll ask after each for our panelists to comment. There are three themes that predominate in Turangalîla: statue, flower, and love. In the frenetic opening of the first movement, the statue theme is introduced on trombones and tuba, seven continuous brass chords intended to evoke dread and terror are punctuated by swooping notes on the Ont Martenot. Let us hear and also see this in this first clip of the first movement. What I'm not sure if you can tell up on the screen is that is, do you have a perspective on that? The orchestra is down underneath those horizontal lines there. So what you're looking at is a view from, say, the upper balcony of the Schnitz, where all around the outside of the orchestra, on the proscenium and on the walls of the Schnitz, are these projections. Can you tell that in this video? Okay, great. Carlos, tell us in this first movement, what are we hearing? And then I want to hear from Rose about how it is she was trying to create visuals appropriate to this section of the piece.
Well, you mentioned already the statue theme, which is in the trombones. It's very easy to recognize. That's a theme that happens all the time. And this is kind of, this movement is called introduction, actually. And when you start a symphony, and you actually have a symphony that is quite substantial and quite long, it's interesting how you start, and in the case of Messiaen, it starts with an enormous amount of energy, because I think he wanted to kind of get everybody's attention right away. So it's a little bit breathless before the statue theme comes, and very fast and extremely high energy. Energy is one of the components of this work that is all the time there.
Yeah, it starts so big. And I just thought, okay, you gotta go 75 minutes. You know, what do you do with that? It's like, I remember the first time I heard it, I thought, did I start at the end? Is this the fanfare? I mean, so it was, I think with this movement especially, it was this startling, to get across visually a kind of a startling start, but to hold back, to not give it away, to like build in the way that it interweaves this kind of complexity and rhythm throughout, again from this very muscular sorts of sound to this exquisitely tender moments. So, we started the first one. I just thought, this has to be black and white. So the first movement is black and white. And I'll talk about that in a little while, but it's like an experience you want to dance through in a way, in some kind of way. It feels like a dance with the music of stepping away. I don't mean a dance, but you step away. Sometimes you are with the music, sometimes you are going kind of a little counter to the music, and you create this new thing, this new kind of partnership.
So let's move on to a second clip, and then I'm going to want to get Brian's take as well. Between the first movement and the sixth, we experience dissonance and lyricism and the flower theme is introduced. The sixth movement offers a return to tranquility. The piano evokes a bird song. It'd be something if the bird evoked a piano song. And we realize the fullness of the third theme, love. We'll start this clip in the sixth movement, several minutes in, and it lasts for about a minute and a half. So, Carlos, what's going on here in the sixth movement?
Oh, the sixth movement is... So let's just remember for 1 second what this piece is about. So this piece is about love. And Tristan and Isolde play a very, very prominent part in the thought process of Olivier Messiaen. And of course, there are correlations between this work and Tristan et Isolde by Richard Wagner. Now, it has been said, and should be mentioned, that in the second act of Wagner's opera, there is this very lengthy, in part, very intense love scene that pretty much includes whatever you can think of a love scene in opera can. It is all there in Wagner's work. And this is kind of the same with one very different aspect, where Wagner goes with incredibly intensity, it can get loud and maybe even fast at times. This movement does not move at all. It is the, if you think about the idea of love, just immersing yourself into the transcendental part of love without forgetting even the sexuality, then you are immersed in this movement that lasts for a long time, and you want it, like in true life love, you want it to last even longer. It's probably something like a 12-minute piece.
Yeah, 12-minute.
That is very complex in construction, and it doesn't matter at all because it gives you this sense of it's so peaceful.
And Rose, how did you think about this? And what are we seeing when we look at your animation?
You're seeing, this is minimalist animation by one of our recent graduates, Micah Weber, took this one on, and he's a very conceptual kind of animator, and just he fell in love with this movement and just said, please, can I have this? Can I do this one? And we watched it this summer and darkened the room, the students, and we watched it, and it's just an exquisite feeling. And I think, where does that come from? You know, it's like letting the visuals give enough room for the music to be there. They don't overpower. things happen in a way that's maybe some kind of happenstance, and it allows your mind to put those things together, to make the connections between what's happening visually, the gestures. The other thing that I think about of this movement made me think of, yes, it's about love, but it's also about loss. And that complex feeling that happens with love and love that has experienced loss. It's a very human place, and I think looking at Messiaen's life, he had lost his first wife just a few years before he wrote this piece, and he had fallen in love with his new pianist. And so you can imagine the kind of conflict in a situation like that. So it's, I don't know, I just thought that this mic is just the way that he animated would really work well here. And then taking what he did and sort of slowly and subtly building through that. I think a lot of people might see this as my favorite movement. We'll see.
In fact, he wrote this piano part for the woman who would become his second wife. Brian, you saw Rose's studio for the first time last week, and you're seeing these clips for the first time tonight. What's your reaction? How do you think about, you no doubt see parallels in other artists' work?
So it's really exciting to see this, and then having visited Rose at PNCA. And I love being around artists. I love being in art studios. I love that sense of creation, and that's what you get when you go down to PNCA. So it was really exciting to be down there for me, Rose. And I think what you see in this piece, having studied art myself and taught art, is an artist and the people who worked with Rose really understanding the basics of visual arts. I mean, gesture, drawing, color, you'll see that in all these works. And in this piece in particular, you know, when you study life drawing, it's all about the gesture, capturing the energy in the minimal way. How can you get that emotion and that feeling through one singular line? And in this piece in particular, and what you've done, Rose, and your team, is that you've really captured the energy in a very economic way. And I also see in this piece, and what I'm always looking for with artists, where is the artist's hand? Where is the artist's touch? Where is the artist's personality? And what's so beautiful about your animation, Rose, is it comes back to you as an artist. You're not using gimmicks, you're not using electronics to the nth degree that you diminish the artist's hand. What we see here is your personality. We see the artwork emerging, and that's what I love about this, and this is really a wonderful,
yeah,
wonderful
right
element.
On. Say no to filters. But anyway, a good example of that in this piece, where kind of the there are like soft focus lights that come on, those aren't just lights that you get some effect. Those are Micah's drawings that are then blurred out. So they have that same, that is the hand touch. It never goes away. And I think the animated arts department at PNCA, people think, oh yeah, you guys all use computers now and everything. You'd be surprised how many students now are drawing or looking for watercolors, looking for the hand to be alive in this new kind of medium.
And for me, it's absolutely fascinating to see what visual artists can do with a piece like Turangalîla, and I can only compliment you and your entire team for what you did, although I only saw 5 minutes of it, because now that we have seen two excerpts and we are about to see a third, remember what Rose said at the beginning after we heard the beginning of the symphony, which was, oh, this is the fanfare at the end. And how am I going to approach visually a piece that starts like Turangalîla starts without losing momentum and can carry over 75 or 80 minutes of music? It's really difficult because, just because. And I just love this because in a way, the minimalistic approach to the sixth movement is, for me, it's one possibility, but it's a very smart possibility. Because, you know, when you hear this movement, the music doesn't move much. So what you could do as a visual artist is not move much. But that probably wouldn't work over the course of 12 and a half minutes or whatever the length of the movement will be. So you have to contrast without, in my words, let the music still flow. And that works beautifully because, as I said, I know what's coming now.
In the 10th and final movement, Messiaen uses the sonata form with a clear beginning, middle, and end, closing on an extended tonic chord. After the wild sonic ride of the first 9 movements, he sets up this extended moment of joy before an ecstatic close. We're going to see just a little bit because we don't want to give too much away. So, and that's just the beginning of that 10th movement. Carlos, what are we hearing here at the end?
We are hearing actually it's not only the third aspect of this work. There are many more that we could talk about. But for me, it was very important that all of you hear the 10th movement because of the aspect of joy, which is so crucial in this work. So what you heard so far was one excerpt that was very majestic and erupts very roughly. Then you heard this transcendental love movement that barely moves and gives room for eternity. And I thought, well, I know a little bit about Olivier Messiaen as a composer, and Olivier Messiaen was always fascinated by either religion, which has no role whatsoever in Turangalîla, or by ornithology, birds. And you heard actually birds in the sixth movement excerpt, but what was always also important when Messiaen felt joyous, it was a joy that was absolutely overwhelming. And just listening to this and seeing the work, the visual work that you all can see when you come to the concert hall, it will be, I can only tell you from experience and knowledge, you have to actually, also everybody who is watching us right now live, you have to come and see that, because two aspects, the visual is way bigger than what we could see now on this screen, and number two, the audio is so much more powerful than even this good system that we have here at Portland Art Museum can be. You are going to be absolutely like, wow.
Yeah, the scale. I think scale is something that has intrigued me ever since the time I did my first installation. What happens when you leave the traditional screen, the rectangle? And what happens when you're dealing with a particular space, whether that's a building or, in this case, this ornate hall, 1910, right? What happens with that? I mean, just to see, and I don't know, I can't see this screen very well from my angle. I hope that it looks better to you than it does to me, but it's difficult to know how tall, what that distance is from the stage to the very top, and to think of yourself in this space with this sound that is so extraordinary. And then these visuals, we have like really heavy duty projectors. They're huge projectors. And what these projectors do that your little office projector doesn't do is they project black. Not that washed out gray, you know? So in a way we have like this power or this opportunity to sort of, I don't want to say negate or obliterate or whatever, but we can take the room away and create this other kind of mysterious depth. And the other thing that we can do is we can accentuate the architecture. It's almost like projectors will become a new kind of stage lighting, a new kind of environmental, a way to experience your environment.
Brian, I want to ask you to give a broader historical perspective on animation and music, but any other reactions first before we do that to what you're saying?
Wow, that's powerful, and that'll be really fantastic. And I'll touch on this a little bit more, but color is really important here, and I want to talk a little bit about that. So, I mean, I think, you know, as I always reflect on works of art and experiences, I always go back in history. Where is this coming from? Where have I been informed? And how is this continuing the dialogue and the narrative in the history of art? And I think in this idea of visual art and music, it's sort of nice to sit in this room, which is a neoclassical sort of rendition of Greek and Roman architecture. And it really does start with the Pythagoreans, where they had this great quote, "The eyes are made for astronomy, the ears for harmony, and these are the sister sciences." This idea of these two worlds coming together goes way back in time. In the 19th century, the great Victorian critic Walter Pater once announced, "All art aspires towards the condition of music." And I think that's so true. Ultimately, when we get to Henri Matisse here from 1910, the great masterpiece that now resides at the Hermitage in St. Petersburg, The Dance, we really start to understand an artist exploring the senses and the muses and bringing these two art forms to the fullest. These are figures embraced in harmony, and he is using color to understand the sky, the earth, and the human condition coming together. And these figures are not perfectly aligned. They're sort of pulled together in this tension as in this composition. The next slide would be Henri Matisse's, also from 1910, Music, where he tried to capture that essence of man's and humankind's creation of music, that harmony, the peacefulness that you must feel and the musicians must feel when they are creating. And I know as a visual artist, you have that sense of timelessness. And I think this picture in particular captures that. All of these pictures were actually, Matisse was, his patron was Sergei Shchukin, which is now showing major works from his collection in Paris. So if you're in Paris, go to the Louis Vuitton Museum, the new museum that's opened up there, and major masterpieces from this collection, which are hardly ever seen, are now in Paris. So go see that. I think another artist that really comes to mind is Kandinsky, of course, 1914. This is improvisation from 1914, improvisation number 35. And let me quote Kandinsky regarding his work in this area. "Our hearing of color is so precise. Color is a means of exerting a direct influence upon the soul. Color is the keyboard. The artist is the hand that purposely sets the soul vibrating by means of this and that key." And I think this captures it all. And Kandinsky was very interested in the intersection of color and how that affects our inner harmony in our soul. As I reflect on Rose's work, I think this is very important. I could not resist going to German Expressionism. And the next slide sort of captures this. And many of you recall this masterpiece of German film from the early 1920s, Nosferatu. And it was a remake of Dracula done by F.R. Murnau, again, from the early 1900s. And what's so wonderful around this piece is you see these bold images in these forms, less is more, big abstract imagery, dramatic lighting, black and white. And it was so influential, not only for future filmmaking, but also all of art. The Germans, in particular, really understood how to use form to create something special. Next slide, please. And we see this in this piece, and this is the very famous Count Orlok, who is Dracula, walking up the stairs that later influenced film, and we can obviously think of a Psycho in particular, that film where this piece was certainly influential. But what's so interesting around the German Expressionist movement and around German Expression film, and I think it also is something that we deal with, they had very little means. You know, after World War I, the Germans were sort of cut off. The country was in isolation and poor. And so the artists really thought deeply about how can we be creative with very little, something we do in Portland often. And so, you know, how does that work? And I think Rose's piece in particular is tapping into that sensitivity that has informed much of art in the 20th century and even the 21st century. Next slide, please. And then the very famous Metropolis film, also coming out of German Expressionism, and Fritz Lang's very famous piece. And this is a pioneering work of science fiction. But again, I think we can see that imagery of the city, the mechanical, but also the touch of the human hand in this film, which was somewhat well received when it was first introduced, but I think had much more effect later in time with recent critics. Coming to the very contemporary, and for those of you who follow the contemporary art world, there is no way that you can't not think of William Kentridge, the great South African artist, who was, is, and is still practicing to this day. When you go to the art fairs and you go to many museums, you will see his work, and he really pulls into or really taps into his South African experience of apartheid and really using an art to sort of unpack the issues of the time. But one of the great draftsmen of all time and animator, and I'm showing you these two stills here from a number of his pieces, but these are stills because he animates, uses multiple drawings to create works of art unto themselves that are moving. And when I talked to Rose about this, I said, William Kentridge. She said, absolutely, William Kentridge is an informed art form, or someone who is informing, I think, some of the work that you'll see. But I wanted to conclude with this. This is Ellsworth Kelly. And this is Ellsworth Kelly, perhaps not the Ellsworth Kelly we know today. Ellsworth Kelly, the great bold, who recently actually passed away, but big colors, big gestures, big canvases. We did a show here at the museum about 4 or 5 years ago from the prints of Jordan Schnitzer looking at Ellsworth Kelly. But this is Ellsworth Kelly getting to the essence of a floral arrangement. Line is powerful. Line is what captures it. And he started out in the military in Paris, actually using lines to sort of just do these beautiful little still lifes. And in many ways, Rose, I see a lot of this in your work, this, you know, less is more idea. And then finally, this image, and this is the Ellsworth Kelly we know today, again, that is seen throughout museums with these big, bold gestures. And in many ways, again, I think the piece that you will experience with the musical of Messiaen is these big, bold gestures that Rose is putting forth in the visual experience. So again, just a little walk through some other visual art forms that I think you're tapping into and then bringing forward with this piece.
Rose, before we move into the art that has led you to this point, Brian shared the influences of a number of artists, and I wonder if you'll share the influences that you had in conceiving this work.
A lot of the same, I think. I wanted to try to put myself back in the mid-20th century and think about Olivier Messiaen, and he was avant-garde. What was avant-garde then? What was avant-garde in the 30s, the 40s? And how did that manifest in the different art forms? So being from, I have a drawing and painting background. I never took an animation course except a night class at the Film Center. I just am a person that discovered in my 20s that my work had to move. Much like I think William Kentridge, it's like he doesn't even call himself an animator, he just makes moving pictures or something, you know. So it's the avant-garde. It is in film, people like Oscar Fischinger, German abstract animator, sort of pseudoscientist. Len Lai, New Zealander, did this wonderful color choreographed short pieces. The short film, it's like we don't get to see the short film very much in America. I think that's one of the things at PNCA that we try to do is show people this work from Europe, from Canada, from around, that is this short form. It's almost like if you just had a steady diet of novels, no poetry. Life would be a little dull. So, so I think it's Fischinger, it's Len Lai, and it's the idea of nonlinear narrative. It's the idea of how do fragments come together to make something bigger? How do you orchestrate to create an arc of feeling if you don't have dialogue and plot? And I think music shows us that. So that way, it was just a delight. Well, not totally a delight, but it was, I just feel so honored to be able to bring something to this piece of music. And so thank you very much for that.
And what are we looking at here?
Talk about less is more. This is my first film, okay? And like I said, I took a night class at the Northwest Film Center because I had seen some of the work from Canada. And I thought, oh my God, that's not cartoons. That's like paintings that move. I want to do that. And so I had no technical expertise. And so this was made by drawing on 16 millimeter clear film. Okay, there's people in this room know what 16 millimeter clear film is. You know what 16 millimeters, that's tiny, okay? So I'm using a pen and the film cost me $30 to buy the clear leader and a rapidograph pen and black magic ink and 1 year working on it. And then taking it to the lab and having this film and getting the sound married to it after that. But it's the idea of you can't do much in that little zone and learning almost like this Zen thing of what don't you put in? What do you really need to put in? That gives you an idea of what it was like to work in that area. I wear glasses now. Here's, I switched to 35 millimeter. I just made one film on the 16 and then discovered 35 millimeter. But here you can see, when you're in this zone of thinking frame by frame, it's like we see things so quickly. I remember seeing a Super 8 film of myself, and I was like goofing around. Before I was going to go show like my first film, and I was like jumping up on a table, right? And I sort of missed and kind of caught myself. When I went back and I looked at that film, frame by frame, it's like you see the expressions, just this fragment of expression that changes on this frame by frame level. And I thought, wow, if I could get some of that to get across this emotion that comes across at this level that you're not even aware of, I think. That's kind of the fascinating thing about animation to me. Here's some stills. I was trying to make some little postcards. In the late 90s, I was feeling that the computers were becoming more affordable, and so I learned this program, After Effects, and I began to work in this new way, this new, bigger way, like normal size film, and where I could bring in my hand-painted stuff, I could bring in photographs, and I could bring in these textures and then do what they call compositing and create this manipulation of time. Big breakthrough for me, though, was learning that there's more than one screen, that this idea of multi-channel work, and Jackie Peterson, you're here in the audience tonight, gave me this opportunity to work with the history of a building in Northwest Portland. So this was my first animated installation. I'll just say one thing. When I was making this project, the projectors are inside the building. Let's do the next slide. The projectors are inside the building. You're standing outside on the street watching. And I had seen this on my computer 100 times. But the first time I was down in the street, looking up, and we were testing, and it got dark, and we turned, I said, Steve, turn it on. And he turned that on, and I saw those silhouettes in the windows. And it was as if they weren't mine anymore. It was this, as if they belonged to the building. They were just emanating out from there. So I was pretty hooked. This is a pretty bad photo, but it shows you the next project I did was in New York at the Eldridge Street Synagogue. Same type of thing of looking into the layers and accretions of memories that buildings have and trying to present that in some kind of maybe not so much nonlinear way. This was one where I had quite a bit of fun taking on the creative process and the idea of creative blocks. It was called Intramuros. That was in Northwest Portland. You might know that building over on Northwest Hoyt and 12th, 11th. That piece I made that it would fit in different buildings. So here it is in the City Hall in Utrecht, Holland. That was kind of fun to do this piece in that building. They loved it. I got another commission or invitation to do a piece in the United Kingdom in Exeter. This is the Exeter Castle, they call it. It's really a courthouse. It was a site of British justice back to 800 AD or whatever. And this gave me an opportunity to talk and make work about a theme, not just about the history of that building, but about what is this place about? And for me, I picked it was about justice. And justice has this great, you know, justice, the British system, trial by jury, not just some whim, trumped up king. Or you have this other side to justice. As a lawyer guy told me out in the courtyard, we were watching it, he had defended people. And he said, if you go down the basement, the original cells are still there. And it's just, it's almost medieval. And it looked back, and I looked back over the history of the place, and I found the names of all the people who were hung out of this courthouse and what their crimes were. And you look at that, and you just can't help but think about the differences in class that happen still in our justice system. So that kind of dichotomy is really what interests me now. But Illumination, this isn't Illumination, this is Intramuros, I mislabeled that one. This was in Zagreb. This is the Museum of Contemporary Art in Zagreb, where they have LED screens over one whole wall of this museum. Looks like it's gonna take off, and I got to choreograph a piece, or re-choreograph that for this site. And then this is the last slide, again, Intramuros, which has been around. This is Nuit Blanche in Toronto, where they get about 1 million people coming out on the streets from 7 at night till 7 in the morning. I mean, people are coming downtown that don't usually see contemporary art. They're wearing their maple leaf sweaters, you know, the Canadians. Anyway, I want to show, for those of you that haven't seen this, you'll see just a little clip. It's about a minute or two long. And so you'll get an idea of what it actually looks like when this kind of animation engages a building. But don't just look at the building. You just learn what I learned, which is, yes, there's my work up in the windows, but just as important is what's happening down here. Who's coming? People that usually go to art events, people that are going to a drag show at Darcel's, people that are going to a Chinese dinner, all these people then mix and have this experience in the street.
So Rose, in all of these examples, when you've worked with music, it's been pre-recorded. You know exactly how long some section's gonna take. And with all due respect to Carlos, we don't know how long every section is going to take precisely. So how is it that you're gonna work in a live setting like that?
Yeah. Good point, Scott. That's one of the huge challenges. First, it's the length. Okay, I'm like a short filmmaker. This is my first feature. And it's not only a feature, it's a feature for four screens. And it needs to be played live. So what we've done is we've figured out where these cue points are, and we will be sitting up with Norman, the assistant conductor there, calling cues so that we can stay reasonably with the music without getting too anal about it. Yeah. So. Yeah.
And Carlos, how is this going to be for you? Because unlike most artists with which you collaborate, you're not going to see what's going on. You don't get to direct what is happening in the hall around you.
Oh, that's horrible.
Did you realize that?
No, you know, the thing is, this is a piece of music that, although, I mean, every piece of music allows the interpreter some freedom. But I would say this is a piece of music that is, where the differences are not gigantic per se. And I'm very grateful that Rose and her team put in kind of a safety net somewhere, which I have no idea where it is. And I can already figure that maybe after the first rehearsal that we do together, you're going to have a little more gray hair. And like, what are you doing? This is way too fast, this is way too slow, and we'll figure it out. The thing is, of course, Rose had to work with a recording. And I know which recording it is, so...
I told him.
Yeah. So essentially, I know the recording, and I try not to go too far away.
So Rose, you worked with a team here, and I want to ask mm-hmm. John Summerson, who's sitting here in the front row, to talk about how it is that you thought about this work and what it was like working with Rose and her team.
Thanks. Rose approached me. I'm an alumni from PNCA to come work on this piece, and it was great. She hands me this music, this pre-recorded music, and like any good dedicated young artist, I promptly went on vacation. And so the nice thing about traveling is there's a lot of downtime and a lot of sitting on trains and planes. So I listened to the music for weeks and didn't have any other input. That was it. And I was trying really hard not to think too hard about it. And the thing that ended up really striking me just listening to this music is its depth, its texture, how like wildly bombastic it is, and then how peaceful and sweet, and it just draws you in, and it's really delicate and sometimes delicate and seemingly like uncontrollable at the same time. So I go, oh, watercolor. That's what I'm gonna do. That's delicate and uncontrollable and textured and beautiful, and that's okay. That's what I'm gonna do. So that was the upshot of my 3 weeks of research. I wanted to come back to town and do my real research. So instead of sitting here being like, well, I'm gonna paint this because this music is pretty, I love a good story. I wanted to go see what Olivier Messiaen knew about love. Because there's a piece about love, and he knew a lot, I think. We talked about his first wife and his second, and the loss that he experienced in that. So I went on the most reputable of sources for research, YouTube. and I found old Olivier Messiaen walking through a field with a blank score, listening to birds. And he's just, oh, he gets a good one, and he writes it down, and I'm like, this guy's amazing. Like, he's so excited about birds. Like, wonderful. So what if I were to do the same kind of thing, to walk through his story, his biography, really the way he experienced love, with my own little blank score, and not be too literal about it, and paint it, and see what happens. So without giving too much away, I worked in the ninth movement primarily, so that's when you'll see that. That was my process.
Thanks, John. Brian, video art is a relatively new form of art, and I wonder your perspective on it as we're living through the evolution through artists like Rose, how you think of it contrasted against static forms like painting and sculpture and drawing. Is this yet considered the art form? You know, we're in the midst of the Andy Warhol exhibit just yards away from where we're sitting, and he was avant-garde at his time, and now that's considered. So talk to us about where we are today in this art form.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's burgeoning. I think we're on something really exciting. I think the interesting aspect is if you think about the history, at least, of museums and collecting, we always thought about painting and sculpture. I mean, that was what it was. And then drawings finally came in, and photographs were somewhere out there, and they've come into the mainstream. And I think the moving image and video in particular and video works have really started to make their play. We as an institution have invested in this and have shown a number of pieces. Right now we have Steve McQueen piece up, and Steve McQueen is that artist who not only directed 12 Years a Slave, but has also started out as a visual artist, very successful one. So we've explored this. I think what I tell audiences about video art is you do have to work at it. You have to spend time with it. You have to slow your life down. You have to invest the time to experience it and to really stop and really be aware of your surroundings. And again, some of the pieces, at least, that contemporary artists are producing, it could be 5 minutes, it could be 10, it could be 20, it could be 30. So again, you really need to take that time to invest in it, which is counter, I think, to what we experience in our day-to-day lives, where the pace of our lives is picking up. And I think this is an art form that we do need to really slow down to appreciate.
I'd like at this point to open up to the audience for questions, and that audience goes for those of you who are watching online as well. Who's got a question? Please.
Or while you're thinking about questions, sorry. I want to just point one thing out to just calm down every purist who is actually watching us. And I actually want to say something about the relationship between the art form of classical music with any other art form. I am very much in the corner that there is nothing that is sacred, and there shouldn't be anything that is sacred. Yes, it's true that probably most of the pieces that can be related to something visual might not even need it, but I actually am a true believer that the visual, first of all, we live in visual times and there is no way around it. And second, for us who are in this art, strange art form of doing concerts, it actually opens an entire world out there that we have not experienced. And for you as audience member, it does it as well. I remember the first time I was exposed to something like this, where I thought like, hell no, which was in the later 80s in Hamburg. I was on my first job as music director of Hamburg Symphony Orchestra, and the Hamburg Ballet was choreographing symphonies by Gustav Mahler. And I thought like, hell no, it's Mahler, leave him alone. And what I have learned in the meantime, some years have gone by, is of course, choreograph, paint, animate, do anything, because it only, at the end of the day, it only adds an aspect that wasn't there before. And as I said at the beginning, the art form, yours, mine, or let's say not mine, but the composer's art form, remains what it is still.
We have an opportunity to experience that art, that music on a different level. We have a question over here.
Yeah, I think this is very exciting. This commission, a locally commissioned piece with an art museum, an art school, and an orchestra. And I was just wondering, do you foresee or think that this production could be shared with other orchestras across the country? Or the world for that matter, or at least the concept of this kind of collaboration?
Rose, are you for hire?
Yes. I'd like nothing better than to do this again somewhere, yeah, yeah.
And Carlos, this would be exciting if one or more orchestras would want to take
I actually think that, I mean, I can only hope that a lot of people who are in the arts hear about our own production can come here to Portland and see it and then bring it to their own cities. It's absolutely worth it.
You said that Rose worked with a recording. I also wondered, Rose, if you had an opportunity to work with the actual pianist or talk with and learn from the actual pianist who will be coming to do the performance in December.
No, the piece that I worked with was a piece that was recorded in Paris and Messiaen was still alive. And so his wife Yvonne was the pianist at that time. I think it was one of the first ones where I think Messiaen felt like symphony had kind of gone astray, and so he came in and put his imprimatur on this version. At least that's what Charles told me. So, yeah.
And
I also heard that he only wanted to hear her playing that work and nobody else.
Well, and let me just say one thing that is very interesting in this work, because you definitely need a piano soloist for this work. However, it's not a piano concerto, although the piano plays an incredibly prominent role in the work, but it's not a piano concerto, and the piano is mostly integrated within the orchestra. It has some very prominent cadenzas that, in this case, Stephen Osborne will play on his own. But essentially, and the other very interesting aspect about how Messiaen treats the piano in this work is the piano is a mainly percussion instrument, kind of. It's not, the piano in Turangalîla does not carry melody, doesn't. It carries, the word texture is very, very important in this work. It has been said, and I don't know whether in words is so easy to understand what I mean by that, that this piece is a piece that doesn't horizontally move that much. For example, the movement number 6, the movement about love, doesn't move that much, meaning not so much happens in the course of time, but vertically, in terms of text, the word texture is so important. What happens is over the top rich. And yeah, that's just an addition to the idea of piano playing in this piece.
There's a microphone coming right here.
Coming up. In terms of it being a piano concerto or not being a piano concerto, how's the piano presented on stage? Will it be up front as if it was a concerto, or will it be part of the orchestra?
There is pretty much only kind of one way to do this, because it's a large orchestra, and the Ont Martenot and the piano. So the piano is in my back, where the piano usually is, and the Ont Martenot is on my left, also front.
More questions? There's a hand.
I don't want to in any way trivialize what you are doing. It sounds absolutely magnificent, but it's interesting you've made no mention whatsoever of Fantasia, one of my childhood favorites. And at least the opening piece of Fantasia, as I recall, has a rather abstract animation with it. Did it come to your mind at all, Rose or Carlos, as you were doing this?
Certainly. I know Fantasia. I saw Fantasia. I didn't want to illustrate like a story or a narrative as much as I wanted to stay with this kind of nonlinear kind of structure. Oscar Fischinger is the one that probably did that abstract movement. Okay, Oscar Fischinger did the whole movement, did animation for the whole movement that turned out to be the one that Walt Disney didn't like and substituted Mickey Mouse with brooms. I'm annoyed by that still. So yeah, it's not Fantasia.
Just to stay from one minute, but at Fantasia, the thing that Fantasia, and the word is illustrating. This is not illustration at all, what you see. And I remember, you know, just a word about this fantastic work that is called Fantasia by Walt Disney. I remember seeing it when I was a kid, and I really hated it. It's a work for adults, because I hated it until Mickey Mouse appeared, then I loved it.
I was the opposite. No, I just...
I saw some hands. I didn't want to turn you down, sorry. Questions?
I'm going to put our associate conductor, Norman Nguyen, on the spot here in a second, but first I see a hand.
There, in the middle.
A microphone's coming to you here.
This is more of what I don't understand. This maybe Rose can help me. That sometimes when we listen to the sound, you have imagination.
Yes.
Then when you have image, sometimes we limit our imagination. So what's your thought about that for this particular piece of music?
No, I know what you're saying. It's sort of like, don't see the movie, it just wrecked the book. You can always shut your eyes, okay? Yeah. I don't know about that, you know? I don't know. I just know that there's enough going on where different people will see different things. And so there's a differentiation of, the possibility of a differentiated experience, which I think is different than going to sit to a movie or whatever, where pretty much you're passively taking that in. I'm really, in my work, very interested in the idea of an active viewer. A viewer who looks, who doesn't look, who talks, who goes. I'm very interested in breaking that kind of just funnel feeling of here's the image, you know, take it. So, I think we're exploring something new. We don't know, you know.
I want to add a little bit. I think you can't resist architecture. I mean, no matter what, whenever you're in a symphony hall, there's architecture. And although it's maybe not moving, there's lighting, there's forms, and we're talking about the Schnitzer Hall of 1910. That is an art form. You are immediately overwhelmed, or at least you sense visually what is going on there. I think the only way to experience music in its purest form is maybe in a black box with your eyes closed.
And one other thing that also maybe helps to understand why, at least I don't think that what Rose does limits, because I think that your experience as a listener and as a person who looks is because I actually think that both the work of the Oregon Symphony with me conducting as well as Rose's work just opens you, and what you do with it is actually your problem. What I mean is, just to give you an example about the rehearsal work with the Oregon Symphony that I do on pieces that are a little less abstract and modern like this, sometimes I have told the orchestra, you know, this has to sound like you are immersing yourself in a warm bubble bath after work. And of course, everybody's like, huh? And something in the sound of the orchestra changes, although I bet that of the 75 musicians in front of me, there are 50 opinions at least how that feels. So your experience is important as well.
Well, let me ask one last question of the panelists. What are you, in a few words, looking most forward to in this production? December 6th.
December 6th, yeah. Seeing it in the space, actually feeling it. It's not seeing it, I want to feel it. Yeah.
I look forward to a very full house and very interested people. And I look forward and I hope very much that 2 weeks after Rose or us, we receive the call and somebody says, hey, I live in God knows what other city. Can we bring this production? That would be nice.
You know, I was reading one of my colleagues today, and he wrote about this idea, cities mature and cities evolve and cities become more global. Sometimes cities lose that sense of creating. They become presenting cities. They import, they bring there. And I think what's so important about this work in particular, and I think the question over here touched on it, this is about our city creating. Our city needs to continue to create. Our institutions, our community needs to be creators, and I think this does it, and I'm so happy about that.
So we're coming to the end of our time, and so my last question is to all of you. Would you please put your hands together and thank the panelists for this program?
Thank you.
We're grateful to all of you, thanks, and grateful to all of you for coming today, grateful to all of you who are watching online. Special thanks again to the Oregon Community Foundation and Umpqua Bank for making this program possible. We're looking forward to seeing you at the Oregon Symphony's production of Turangalîla on December 3rd, 4th, and 5th, and at our next multimedia panel later this spring. This concludes our program and live stream. Thank you for joining us.